So let's start the activities of our thematic program this morning. We just want to do a brief introduction, a brief opening. So we have the director of IMPA here, Professor Cesar Camacho. And I'm going to call some of the of our organizing committee members here and the scientific committee members here to the table here, so we can just do a brief opening. So Professor Cesar Camacho, please. Be the first member on the table. And then on behalf of our organizing committee, let me invite Professor Eduardo Teixeira from FC to also sit here. Professor Boyan Sirakov from PUC Rio. And Professor Diego Moreira from UFC to take a seat here. Professor Ricardo Alonso from PUC is also part of our organizing committee, but is not here today. And let me call Professor Luis Caffarelli from our scientific committee and Professor Irene Gamba to just take a seat here at the table with us. This is nothing formal. It's just a few words by the director and some of our committee members.
Hi, how are you? Nice to meet you. Hola, ¿qué tal? ¿Cómo estás? ¿Cómo te va? Okay, vamos a sentar, por favor.
Well, good morning. It is a pleasure to welcome all participants in this international workshop on elliptic and kinetic partial differential equations as part of the thematic program Current Trends in Analysis and PDEs. I wish to thank Emmanuel Carneiro and all the members of the organizing committee, Eduardo Teixeira, Diego Moreira, Boyan Sirakov, as well as the scientific committee, to which we add two important people, Irene Gamba and our friend Luis Caffarelli. Thank you for being here. Since some of you come here for the first time, I wish to take this opportunity to make briefly some considerations concerning mathematics and IMPA and in Brazil. We are presently living through a process of expansion of the mathematical activities in Brazil and in particular at IMPA. This process started 15 years ago and brought as a consequence in particular, a considerable growth of the number of researchers. The number of researchers in the scientific staff of IMPA increased by 50% in the last 10 years. And right now, we are 50, and we are in the process of expanding this scientific staff. At the end of this year, for instance, we will open new tenure track positions in any area of mathematics, and we wish to encourage young mathematicians from all over the world to apply. So please pass on these words. We are very much interested now in renewing our scientific board. At the same time, a good measure of our scientific activity has been given by the number of scientific visits, which more than tripled during the last 10 years. Right now, IMPA receives around 700 a month a year of visiting researchers. 700 a month, that means that means to more than double the number of members of our faculty. On the other hand, we recognize that the main problem of Brazilian mathematics nowadays is that it is still lacking in diversity. The number of areas of mathematics needs to be enlarged in the near future, and also the number of students. Along this direction, you probably know that since 10 years ago, we organized a large-scale Olympiad of Mathematics for the students of public schools in Brazil. This is a large number of students. Each year, this activity involves the participation of 18 million of students, which is approximately 10% of the Brazilian population. This has proven to be an excellent source of talented people for mathematics, and certainly will be very important for Brazilian mathematics in the future. On the other hand, recently, IMPA received a very important donation of a piece of land contiguous to IMPA, with an area much bigger than that of the present location. In fact, it has 8 times the area of the present location. This will allow us to increase the number of students to whom we will be able to offer a residence and to increase the number of research visitors as well. We estimate that in 4 to 5 years from now, when the new buildings are expected to be ready, the number of students should double. Right now, we have around 150 to 170 graduate students. Well, given this short picture of IMPA, I would like to finish to thanking again the organizers of this conference, renew our warm welcome to all of you, wishing a fruitful meeting and a nice stay at IMPA and in Rio de Janeiro. Please be careful, don't catch a cold as I did.
Thank you, Cesar, for the kind words. So on behalf of our organizing committee, I would just like to say a few words. First of all, a warm welcome to all of you to Rio, to IMPA. First, many of you are coming here maybe for the first time, so I hope you have a pleasant stay in Rio and enjoy our institute. As Cesar just described, we are in the process of enlarging our institute, right? We are maybe 3-4 years down the road when you visit the institute, we'll have doubled its size. It's a statement that mathematics here, not only in Brazil, but in South America, mathematics nowadays is global, and math in South America is as good as it can be. And a statement for you is just many of you are coming here, and we are very pleased to have you here. It's because of distinguished scientists like you coming and spreading the good word of mathematics around the world that we are in this position today. I cannot thank more our leading scientific advisors for this program, Professor Luis Caffarelli and Irene Gamba, which are a true statement of these ambassadors of Latin American mathematics all over the world. This organizing committee has worked hard over the last years in preparing this program, so I wish you enjoy, if you are a PhD student or a postdoc, enjoy the time here, enjoy the exchange of ideas with your colleagues. We were discussing yesterday, right? Enjoy the beauties of Rio. You know, we have a lot of sightseeing tours to see here, the Sugarloaf, the Christ, the botanical gardens. And this organizing committee has brought to you also a Picasso exhibition at the Banco do Brasil Cultural Center, right? And the World League of Volleyball Finals. So this is also... And, well, without further ado, this is just a warm welcome to you all. And let's have a wonderful meeting. So if anyone else wants to say a few words, it's optional.
Okay, I think we started discussing this meeting 2 years ago already,
yes.
Or three?
Three years ago.
Right, and I think we are very, very happy that we are managed to gather, bring top people at every level, from the lecturers to the students. I think this is going to be a great reunion for everybody to exchange ideas, to learn new things. And so I want to thank from IMPA to Emmanuel and all the committee, to all of you that are here. So thank you very much, and I hope you enjoy your stay.
So activities start this morning. During the day, we're going to have the workshop with 8 mini courses given by distinguished scientists. And at the end of every day, we're going to have the School of High Studies, sponsored by CAPES, by Professor Luis Caffarelli, at 4:30, from 4:30 to 6 every day. So this program is going to run over the next 2 weeks. Okay, so all the lectures are going to be recorded and actually broadcasted live. So if you know any of your friends or your students, postdocs that could not be here, you can just tell them to watch live. They can follow the event here. And they will be actually posted on our YouTube channel afterwards, right? So IMPA has a YouTube channel, which is absolutely free of charge, so everybody can watch all the lectures that are going to go on here over the next 2 weeks. Without further ado, it's a pleasure for me to introduce Professor Li He Wang from the University of Iowa to give our first lecture series. He's going to be talking about the regularity of elliptic PDEs. Li He, if you plan to use the board, our director is going to be projecting upstairs.
Okay. Thanks a lot for the invitation and the introduction. I look at the program, and I think it's really good to talk about the basic stuff of elliptic equations. It's basically used everywhere. So my lecture, I will give 3 lectures. The first one would be about the harmonic functions and the related stuff. And the second lecture, immediately after the first, actually that today, I'll talk about Schroeder estimate. And tomorrow, I will end my lectures with De Georgian and Nash estimate. So I will try to prove all the estimates as much as possible in a geometrical way. And you will see the interplay between algebra and the analysis. So the simplest equation, which is this, this called Laplace equation, or some people call it Poisson. Any solution U is called harmonic. I will show you they basically appear everywhere, where they are really appearing in all the equations, because Laplacian, which is defined this way, and U is a function of n variables. If you look at all the nice differential equations up to second order, the Laplacian is basically the only equation that's independent of observers. You look at gradient U, it depends on the direction. You look at 2 times, you put 2 here, you put x1 into a certain weight, and that depends on the orientation. That's not independent observers. So that's basically a proof. This equation is the simply most important equation for us to study. So what that mean is you, if you see this on the surface value, what it says that n numbers add together equals 0. Right? You take the derivatives of u, 2 derivatives in x1 direction plus 2 derivatives in x2 direction. You have n numbers of them, you add together equals to 0. Whenever those kind of functions that happens, we call that harmonic. So whenever n numbers add together is 0, then you see some positive second order derivatives, which is perfectly balanced by the negative direction. But you have some of them equals to equals to 0. But on the other hand, it's like the balance doesn't really tell you how big it could be. It's this side could be 100 times x1 squared. The other direction could be exactly balanced that in other directions. And you see this is really the simplest example of harmonic function. A deeper one is this one, which called fundamental solution. It behaves like that. It's x1 direction, xn direction. It has a one point. Does not satisfy the equation. If you take the Laplacian of it, that's equals to zero except x equals to zero. I will come back to that function later on. That's basically the harmonic function you should think about. And more importantly, actually, you can make an up harmonic function very easily. For example, you look at the temperature of the water in this bottle. So you look at, say, T equals the temperature at time T. If I let this water table, water bubble set on the table, it will be, eventually this water will be the room temperature. But if I hold it, what's going on is that my hand will feel the water is some kind of cold, and I have an exchange of energy. If I hold it for a while, what happened is that here, let me draw a bottle. I have some water inside. Then I have a hand. So because my hand is always assumed the body temperature, which is more or less like a 36 some degrees, and the rest would be room temperature. If I hold for a while, what happens is that is the energy from my hand will suck into the water, and from here, the energy will escape. And you can imagine that if I hold for a while, the temperature distribution will be stabilized. And at that moment, that temperature distribution is satisfied this equation. So in this situation, what happened is that this very, very quickly actually is beyond the measurement. You get a function independent t because it is stabilized. Then this, let me change this to the letter before, say x, y, z. Then this, I have a harmonic function inside this bottle. And u on the boundary is either room temperature or body temperature. This is really man-made harmonic function. Then what should be the correct understanding of this? Is the temperature distribution inside the bottle, I cannot control it. You should think about this equation as the physical law. It controls every single point inside the water. So what you can change is I can hold the bottle this way or this way. So if I do that, what changes is this boundary condition, right? So you can see that this is very important thing to think about, and this is human can control. And this, for this x, y, z, inside this bottle of omega, that's physical law. So this kind of problem is the problem I want to talk about. And the first theorem I want to say is, you look at this picture. It's at every point, it's a kind of like a saddle. The only thing you're not so sure is how big it is. It's not, but it's like in some direction it's going up, you are guaranteed you can go you find other directions, it goes down. But the thing is, this kind of information is infinitesimal. you can sense it, but how do you write anything down correctly and mathematically? The first theorem is actually fundamental for this. It's called the marking principle. Which is very easy, but this is a foundation of a lot of things. It says following, suppose Laplacian U equals to zero, then let's take this kind of situations. Then suppose, say, U is less or equals to one on the, say, M on the boundary. And suppose this is satisfies this PDE, and I assume omega is bounded. So what then the conclusion is then U is less or equals M inside in omega. It's a very easy statement, but this is the simple, most fundamental statement we have to start out with. What that means is, suppose here's omega. You have a harmonic function U in this direction. Suppose on the boundary is less or equals M. What I mean is it can go up by M, it can go down by M. But it's a theorem, is this covers all kinds of situations, satisfies condition. What I mean is that the boundary can be anything jumping up and down between negative M and M. So you see there are really all kinds of temperature distributions. And because of this saddle kind of things, it's intuitively clear that the function cannot go up in the middle, because go up, it's you have some convexity or concavity at some point that contradicts with this picture. The problem is that this saddleness might have a flat part. You are not that easy to get a contradiction. So the proof is you first think about it intuitively. It's really cannot go up. Then, like the any proof of analysis, you look at this, say the maximum point. So suppose say that. Let's call this the maximum of U of X in omega. Call this, say, little m. So if this m less or equals m, you are done. So the only thing is you are afraid of if this m is bigger than the big M. So this kind of picture happens. So what do you do? You look at, say where it happens. So if this happened, since this is bigger than this M, then this implies that this has to be inside this omega. It's impossible to be on the boundary, because that's the assumption. It's on the boundary. It's less or equals M. So this X is a maximum. And also interior is an interior maximum. So then you look at any analysis book, it says the Hessian at that point is a, since the maximum, the picture basically is something like that. So you get this has to be non-positive definite. But you cannot reach a contradiction. Everything fits, except you take trace of that matrix. This less or equals to zero. So it just fails to reach a contradiction. So in order to reach a mathematical rigor, what you do is two things are important. Is this intuition. You first observe something like this would be true. Next, I mean, we are a group of mathematicians. We want to prove this with mathematical logic. And this is almost true. How can you reach this to be perfectly true? And the geometric way of thinking about this is actually this. Is you look at this maximum here, you go up. Now, how do you get this point? One way to think about this is you draw a plane, a big plane. You just land on this picture. Now, where you land is exactly the plane where you hit the graph at x zero, right? And at that point, if the maximum is a plateau, you feel you reach a constriction, but you cannot reach a constriction by logic. So what you should do is, because you look at the floor, right? This is flat. But are you sure the floor is flat? I say this is Earth, right? So if you change this plane, not a plane, but the surface of Earth, the picture does not change, but it's, the plane will be bent a little bit. Then what you should do is, if this happens, instead of compare this picture by this plane, what you should do is this plane minus, say, epsilon x squared. So you make it, you make epsilon so small, you say the naked eye cannot even see it. And same thing, everything can be said, but you achieve the logic. So in other words, instead of doing this, if this happened, then you will see that u of x will be just compare u with m minus epsilon x squared. Since there's a gap for epsilon small, actually, this small is computable small. Is a smaller than this gap. This is my little m, that is m. Then you reach this picture. Then this maximum point will perturb a little bit. But it doesn't matter. You're guaranteed this point will be very, very close to x zero. So it's also interior. Then at that point, it's the touching point will be concave. And this u of x epsilon equals to this critical power, this c epsilon. And so you get a constriction. Therefore, this Hessian of u will be less or equals to at x epsilon. And this is you get minus, you get plus Laplacian u at x zero epsilon, strictly less than minus two epsilon n, which is contradiction. So this is the, if you let me think, this is the first like a geometrical proof of this of the whole approach. Is you better think about every single step as geometrical as possible. And you shouldn't underestimate this proof. I used all the information. All this, the equation holds everywhere. If you look at this function, this is harmonic, except at one point, it fails. One of the consequences is that if the equation fails at one point, then the maximum principle fails. So you see, it's if you look at here, the on the boundary would be a given number, but in here it's actually is infinity. So this function has a lot of consequences, but one of the consequences is all the theorem you used each and every physical law at every point inside the domain. Of course, you use this information on the boundary. So next, let me talk about the real regularity theory. Theorem 2. Let me to make things easier. Take omega like a ball one. So if I give you harmonic function equals to 0 in ball one. Since we already prove that the maximum always happens on the boundary, wherever you see the boundary is M, inside will be M. Let me then the following theorem is true. U x 0. The gradient of this function later equals C 0 use every infinite norm of this boundary. So before I give you the proof, let me say some consequences of this. It actually says a lot of things. Let me, without generality, lots of generality, let me assume that's one. So what the picture means is this. This domain one, and you look at all the harmonic functions so that the boundary condition is our every infinite norm of the boundary condition equals one. So you see all kinds of temperature distributions. Then from what I say here, or from physical intuition, which I will talk about, is that you give me any boundary distribution, the nature of this PDE will react to this boundary condition. Then inside, you get harmonic function inside. Here, what it says is that no matter what kind of boundary distribution you give me, if it's the every infinite norm equals one, actually less or equals one, you have a lot of harmonic functions taking this boundary data accordingly. Then this harmonic function, of course, will dance with the boundary condition. Then what the U zero is, of course, depends on the boundary condition. Actually, it's always equals to the average. I think one of my colleagues will talk about this kind of average formula, and also equals average of U on the boundary. So this kind of you can obtain from the boundary condition. But what this theorem says is that no matter what you do, the gradient at origin will be uniformly bounded by this C zero. So geometric, what that means at this point, you can draw a little cone. What this mean is at this point you can draw infinitesimal cone both inside, both upside and down below. And the U harmonic function of all of them will be outside. And this conclusion actually is a source of most of regularity theory of elliptic equations. And it has many, many consequences. Let me start with one of consequence. And the most important thing is to think about this C0, like a universal or physical constant. It depends on everything in the universe. It depends on nothing else. It's independent of you. So the mere existence of C0 is the most important statement of this thing. So let me say some consequences and a more geometrical understanding of this before the proof of this. So this is scaling. The simple is the most important idea of this. Suppose Laplacian U, I gave you, you look at physical law in ball of R. Let me gradient U 0. This is how I go see. Use every infinite norm for R of 0 divided by R. So before I do that, let me try to draw a picture. So what does it mean of this? So this R can be anything. So let me draw one dimensional picture. It's minus R to R. Suppose this number is whatever. I mean, in my maximum principle, I call that M. It's the boundary condition jumping between minus M and M. So then you look at all the harmonic functions with the boundary condition between negative M and M. And this says the gradient at the origin is controlled by that. It's a very clear statement. But among all those harmonic function, there's a simplest one, which is this linear function, which connects negative M from this corner to that corner, right? It's the simplest. Then what is the gradient of this function? Of course, exactly M over R, right? Look. So for this linear function, the gradient, the biggest possible gradient among all the linear functions is exactly like a m minus minus m is 2m over 2r. So it's m over r. Then what the theorem says? The theorem says you look at all the possible, like almost like a random distribution of the boundary, all the possible. Then the worst thing you can make so that the gradient at the origin, how big you could make is proportional to this simplest one. That's the statement. So this is very, very important. And so you see this C zero there is means that the estimate is more or less proportional to the simplest observation. And you might think that I have been talking about only at the origin. What happened nearby, the boundary? It seems like this is too special. If I give you this kind of let me give you a proof first. The proof is one line. Is you just, since this is true for any u, I make this ball R change the scale. I just let h of x equals to u of r x. So if you let x runs over the range of unit ball, then r times x will run over exactly running over the whole range, what you saw it before. Then h is clearly harmonic. And the boundary L infinity is not changed by this change variable. So then apply that theorem too. I get gradient U, gradient H at the origin, less or equal C zero, use L infinity. Let me say H of on the boundary of ball one, they are same number. which is same as C zero U of L infinity ball R right there. This dilation does not change the L infinity norm. But what is this? This is simply because of chain rule. It's gradient H at every point equals to R times gradient U of R X. So that means that this equals to R times gradient U of zero. And that's the proof. Very, very precise. U at U's gradient at our origin times R is less or equals C zero U's origin. So this statement. Then you might think, oh, this is really, really easy. But it's extremely powerful. For example, look at this picture. You might think that this is only at the origin. For example, if you see you let the U jumps on the boundary like crazy, then clearly, if you look at the picture upside down, this jumps from here to here. Then the gradient at that point, even the tangential gradient at that boundary will be quasi infinity, right? So this kind of gradient estimate cannot be held near the boundary because you knew the reasonable guess near the at the boundary, the gradient should be infinity. Then you might wonder, what do we have precise estimate how the gradient blows up along any ray? Because this only talk about at the origin. And guess what? This simple looking estimate implies all the things you wanted to estimate. So pick a point here, say X in ball one. Right? Then this is a mathematical theorem. Mathematical theorem says that this is true for any origin. It's like you can name any point in the universe the origin. And everybody thinks like he or she is the center of the universe. So this R is not very important at all. This is like just a length scale. So you can take R anything. And you pick this point, then of course you draw the biggest ball that's allowed to think about this question. So you see that ball 1 minus x, u will be harmonic there. Right? It's clear. Then what is the base and the height for this harmonic function in this ball? The height still this number, because the maximum here is also how u jumps there. So you get u of gradient at center of this ball is less or equals the same constant divided by the radius of this ball times u's area infinity norm of ball this thing. You see? You just apply that. And this, of course, less or equals C, zero, use L infinity for one. And guess what? This is very, very precise estimate, which tell you how gradient blows up near the boundary in this kind of situations. And a deeper consequence of this is that, say, let X in runs over half ball. That statement, the corollary, implies the following statement, gradient U, X, L infinity ball half, less or equals, maybe not the same constant, you take X your half, this doubled, 2C zero, use L infinity ball. F Laplacian U equals zero. So what we just did is our theorem 2 is a point-wise, one-point estimate. Then what is this? Is we call this kind of estimate, local estimate. It's in ball 1, we estimate all the things in half of the ball. Actually, what this means is very profound, is that you see point-wise estimate, one-point estimate implies half ball's estimate, right? I just show it for you. And if I give you half ball's estimate, of course it implies one-point estimate, right? You see? So point and the local region, they are equivalent. Which also means a lot of things. It's like the estimate in half ball equivalent to the estimate, say three-quarter balls, if you go over this procedure. So this radius, the gap, is irrelevant. Because I just thought from one point, you know, implies everything. Not only everything, I can go up to the boundary if I want to. So this is how powerful it is. And this trick is really the most fundamental one. It's called scaling. You look at the estimates truly in geometrical and physical way. In the essence that physically, what is one? There's no one in the universe. One is totally artificial, and there's no origin. So the correct way of understanding this estimate, is actually this one. These two are totally equivalent. And you should understand one in liberal way and in the correct way. And this is corollary one. Corollary two is once I get the gradient in half ball, then I can go higher all the derivatives. It's clear that Laplacian u equals 0 in ball 1. Then Laplacian gradient u equals 0 also in ball 1. You just take gradient. Then the gradient will be Hessian. Then this will be bounded. You iterate this two twice. Let me just write this way. Then I erase this thinking. It's very easy to prove, right? And if I prove that, I can also turn this into a local estimate. Let me put the two statements together, not only local estimate. I let my one universal. You follow me? So in ball R, then du square L infinity ball R over 2, less or equals to maybe C1 bar use L infinity. And I have to divide R squared. So at this point, it's really a good moment to tell you how do you write it without too much thinking. And the word scaling physically really means a scale. Is you should make scale correct. Then you write down the estimate without much thinking. Of course, one of the ways of thinking about this is you draw a parabola inside this cube, then you see what's going on. And a better way of thinking about this is that you look at U. U will have, like the temperature in the bottle, have the temperature scale. Then what is the derivative scale? The scale of this is U scale right, like it used like a calories or whatever it wanted to use, divide by tension is taking derivative twice, right? Then what is taking derivative twice? You divide by distance twice. this has the distance square scale. Right? It's clear, because taking derivative is whatever u scale divided by distance once. Then two derivative is u scale divided by distance twice. Then you see this kind of item exactly makes the two sides the scale matches. Here u scale divided by distance twice. It's always like this. You can blindly write down estimates. If it's reasonable, it will be true. And corollary prime, be like, you can write any other you want. If Laplacian u equals zero, say in bar, then any other derivative. Would be there's a constant, depends on that multi-index. Is r to the length of that, and this alpha length. I mean, everyone knows, right? It's alpha 1 plus alpha plus. So it's wonderful and easy. Okay, so let me prove of this theorem. And for human being, you better, when you prove this, you better scale to one, because it just hurts you brain if you think about arbitrary R. It's just normalize everything. So actually, I learned how many tricks from Louis. One is the thing you better think about. Before I do that, let me write a remark. It's a maximum principle. If you look at the proofs, holds for, say, sub/super harmonic functions. If you look at the proof, because we are compared the solution from one side, so the theorem 1 prime can be thought about this following. Suppose Laplacian U is my picture is say bigger or equals to zero. This is called subharmonic. In ball one, then the sup of u in ball one is less or equals to the sup of u on the boundary. The exactly same proof, nothing changes, and there's a symmetric one. If this less or equals to zero, we call that superharmonic. And this concept actually very useful for my lectures tomorrow. And this would be, is I have to change it to other way around. It's actually on the boundary. It's ultra true. So how do I prove something like this? This should be thought like pointwise / local estimate. If you make this condition a little bit stronger, it's very easy to do. If you change this condition into gradient u along the boundary, you just use gradient u is harmonic, immediately you get this less or equal, like one times that. But what this picture says is that you have a regularity. Is that even the boundary condition runs like crazy, then what you see inside the gradient is always bounded by a universal number. Not only that, it means something more geometrical is let me draw this picture. Every infinity say ball half. Say this all equals to I forget the constant, say C is twice of C. There. What's the meaning of this is that a wonderful picture. This means ux minus uy. By mean value theorem, this equals gradient u some x theta times x minus y, right? So I put everywhere absolute values, and that's bounded. It's less or equals to 2c0 x minus y. Of course, this equivalent to two inequalities. And the bigger equals to negative c x minus y. Now you're thinking y as a parameter. You think x as your value, y as a parameter. What is this picture? This is exactly this cone. And this divided by that is this number. This tangent of this angle equals that. Then what this inequality really means is that at each point, you draw this, which is a cone, and that your function is always below this cone. And at every point, you can draw this cone. And if you look at the other side of inequality, you can draw this cone down below. So gradient estimate has this wonderful geometrical interpretation, is that at every point inside ball half, you can draw a cone above and also draw a cone below. Then this cone is not infinitesimal anymore. This is infinitesimal estimate. Once you have the local estimate, you draw this global cone inside half ball. So you make a quantum leap from infinitesimal to the whole half ball. And that is what the geometry means. So now, how do you prove it? There are several proofs. And I think in other lectures, people will talk about other things. So let me try to prove it using the what we just proved, the maximum principle. So several easy computations. So first of all, if u is harmonic, you will observe that u squared is subharmonic. Actually, for any u, this is twice of a Laplacian u. This is pure algebraic identity. It's always true for any u. So that equals to 0 is 2 gradient u squared. So it's bigger or equals to 0. That means that this is subharmonic. Actually, subharmonic, you better think about like some kind of convexity. It better should be called like mean convexity. It's because it's the sum of the second order derivative is bigger or equals to 0. So mean convex. But traditionally, we call that subharmonic. So let's just call that subharmonic. So it's some kind of convexity. So the maximum of u squared is achieved on the boundary. We knew that. But this is rather qualitative. So next computation you make is gradient u squared. Of course, you get the same thing, because each component satisfies that inequality, that identity, of course. I will have like gradient of the gradient. Then what I want to do is I want to estimate the gradient at the origin without using the gradient near the boundary. So what should I do? I just do it like by force. I do a cutoff. Eta is C dear. So the purpose of that is since I don't know the control, I don't want to use the control of the grid in, near the boundary. So I just forget it. I just take things, then this product along the boundary will be there. So this, you just do the computation, is a Laplacian this, right? It's a generalized Leibniz rule. Right, it's a, and plus eta square Laplacian of this thing, then that is that. So then you look at this, this is mainly positive. This is bigger or equals to there. And those other terms seems hard to control. But this term, if you expand that, this is gradient U times Hessian of U. You use a correct index. So you see, this is a your enemy, of course, is this is actually this term, but this is a lead. This term is a product of gradient and Hessian. This is linear here. And this is quadratic. And this is, you don't have a sign. So what you try to do, if this was bigger or equals to zero, then you are home. But how do you make that bigger or equals to zero? You think that this has a middle term. This is positive. If here, you can make this is really, really positive, then you can handle that term easily, right? Now, how do you do that? You see here, you have like, this is you can use for free. You know everything about U. So what you do is you take lambda here, then you sum. You get Laplacian of eta square, gradient square, plus lambda u squared, some huge constant times gradient u squared, plus something fixed is actually you can write it down if you want, plus something, and this is eta squared is something that they don't match, but you better just do the expansion. So you write this like x squared, and this like a 2 times 2, this, that thing squared. Then what's left here is 2 gradient eta gradient u squared. But then this is bigger or equals to this still huge gradient u squared minus gradient eta squared. Let me put a epsilon here, divide by the rest. The standard trick, right? So plus eta squared times 2 Hessian squared. Nevertheless, you see, you can make epsilon precise. You can take epsilon like square root of 2. So this will be bigger or equal, this actually equals to 0. But this huge will beat this thing, and this huge also includes some of those terms. But lambda is totally free. So you can make this bigger or equals to zero by taking lambda big enough. And you might observe, it's very important, this the lambda big enough depends only on the cutoff function. It's independent of each harmonic function. So this becomes a subharmonic function. If that subharmonic function, then this guy's maximum anywhere at every point is less or equals to his maximum on the boundary. But when you look at x on the boundary, this term drops. This is lambda u l infinity ball 1. I mean, they are the same. Then you just look at, this is true actually for every x. But let's look at x equals to 0. You get either square 0 greater than 0. This clearly bigger equals that. Then you pick your favorite eta. And that's the proof. So this is L infinity. And let me talk about other things related with harmonic functions. First, of course, this the L2 approach this can be easily reduced to this thing. You just extend this phi, then take the difference. Then this actually take us a lot of time, of like 100 years ago, think about how do you solve this type of equations. And to solve equation, there are several approaches. And the modern way of thinking about how to solve it is actually you don't think about how to solve it. Is you get estimate first. Like what we did. We get this gradient estimate for all the harmonic functions. If we get this physical estimate, of course, we spend like last 100 years to figure out. Once we have the estimate, then we try to prove there are solutions satisfy exactly those kind of estimates. And that's it can be easily said than done. For example, if you compare the modern theory of viscosity solutions, that can be viewed as we have the maximum principle. How do you prove there is a solution satisfy exactly the maximum principle? If you think about this exactly the viscosity solution approach. And what people thought about 100 years ago is another easy estimate which is available. It's actually by the following means. Let me talk about L2 approaches. And the bottom line is really you shouldn't think about where the solution is. It's the question is you better think about how do you control the solution in the means you can handle. For example, here, if you have this, here, what we did is that use maximum is dominated by phi's maximum. So the maximum is under control. And the estimate only says for that is actually the approach of viscosity solutions, which I don't have time to talk about. But let me talk about another approach. It's really nice and beautiful also, and also fits many of the ideas I have to talk about in the second and the third lecture. And here, what we did is look at, compare U with hyperplane. Then we scale it, we do a lot of algebra, then we get a lot of consequences. Here, another approach is we use integral. We times U, then take the integral. Then what kind of estimate we got is you integration by part, right? You here U is UK, UK. And I move this K to the left-hand side. I have two terms. And another term is on the boundary. But if I assume it's on the boundary, it disappears. So this is minus gradient U squared. So in other words, if I switch the sign, I get this. Minus U times I dx. Then what is the estimate? You see here is a quadratic in U, right? It's like U squared. Here's a U. So the quadratic can never balance with linear term. So you feel there's some estimates immediately. And if you do the computation, actually it's pretty easy to do. It's you use Holder estimate. Okay. Then this L2 norm is not that hard to estimate by the gradient if you take a line integral, and that's it's called a Bangerian inequality, but let me use that. There's a concept. I abuse the notion of the constant here. Then again, the right hand side is linear, and the left hand side is quadratic. So you can cancel one of the factor. You get this estimate. Actually, you have to square it. Actually, Hilbert, when he proposed the problem, I think he was look at this estimate more or less exactly. And he cannot, at that time, he cannot figure out how do you use it. And it's more or less took human being like 30 years to understand what should we understand. So a couple of questions. So you have this estimate, right? Then the area infinity or maximum principle, I can draw a picture to show you what's the meaning. I can draw a line. But what is the meaning of gradient U squared? Suppose, let me say it again, this equals 1. So this lets out C0 squared. Maybe that's what you saw. Then I suggest the following. The question is that I gave you a function. The function, his gradient square, is just less or equals to a fixed number. Say that's equals to 100. The question is, what's the meaning of that? Then very quickly, you will reach the following. This estimate doesn't really mean much. It means that the gradient of this function at every point, it might be infinity, maybe huge, maybe huge and small mixed together. Actually, this gradient U squared is nothing but this means that gradient U is a typical L2 function. And I can really back up my word of it. So you take f L2 function. It's a little bit less than this. But you just say solve this one dimension. You can always do it, right? Then you take one more derivative. So you can see that the gradient u prime is really equals f. You take arbitrary f, you can make the gradient exactly that. Then what's the sense of it? So all your imagination about a typical f, that really happens on this function u's derivative. So his derivative is randomly distributed. And to talk about these things further, let me try to explain, say what is a typical L2 function, and what's the geometry of that. That's hard to do. Let me try it anyway. So what do you see? The simplest example, or the simplest inequality, rather, I can do the following. I look at the set U is, F is bigger or equal to, say, a lambda. Then this is bigger or equals to the set 4-1, F bigger or equals to lambda. So I get this x 4-1. And what's a picture of this is you look at f is you cut it by level lambda is like there is a. Then you look at the places where it's beyond that, then that measure have this 1 over lambda decay. That's the inequality you got. Not only that, this is if you replace where u is like f is small, like here. Let me draw the projection. Here is like a million. And here, say, like 100. If you replace this value, where is 100, more or less, where is a million, the same measure, you see that this function's L2 norm does not change at all. And what does not, the form does not change. And this estimate does not change also if you swap them, because the measure exactly the same. So the information carried by the L2 norm is really have this random setting. Is that you shouldn't think about where f is large and where f is small. The value is randomly distributed. It only tell you that the set where f is bigger than certain numbers is decayed like that. And this should be thought better thought about this f is, I will talk about in the second lecture, this like f distribution function is like a Hodler decay at infinity. And that's exactly what it says. But you might, against this argument, saying that, oh, this is such trivial inequality, it's nothing deep of this, it's not precise. But if you write down the precise identity, it is actually here. It's a zero infinity if you do the Fini theorem. This is pure identity. Then this estimate says that this, as a function of lambda, is more or less, or less or equals to 1 over lambda squared. So, but the lambda times lambda squared is like 1 over lambda. And 1 over lambda, the integration, of course, equals infinity. So what this says, actually, if you increase this infinity, the decay, just tiny little bit, we make the precise computation here. So namely that this estimate, if it miss so little, is the naked eye cannot see. Is, I mean, the naked eye, can you tell 1 over lambda squared with 1 over lambda 2 plus epsilon? So this distribution of the decay, of the where this f is huge, has small measure in this precise fashion, is very, very close, and is the correct intuition of this integral estimate. Same thing can be said that this thing is less or equals a constant. Where gradient is big, where gradient is small, exhibits this random behavior. And the random behavior can be random distributed. But what's the information you obtain is where the huge has small measure. And of course, this thing, this small measure of the gradient is more than the function itself, right? If the function is in L2 or gradient is in L2, of course gradient in L2 is stronger than saying that the U is in L2. So we have a couple of questions. Is that how do you define, how do you understand this gradient once you exhibit this gradient has a random behavior? Then under such kind of a general condition, the gradient is big and small, random distributed, can we understand the PDE? And the third, if gradient U square is really in L2, how is that gradient is better than the function itself is in L2? Now all that is the whole school of this of next things, which I don't have time to explain, but I just lay it down here. So understand this gradient in L2. How do you understand this? This is a weak derivative and understanding. Namely that we say ux1 equals to f in L2. Since I get this integral, I get this estimate by integration, you have to understand this by integration. So what this means is that I times phi, then take integral, then I integration by part, then this phi x I u. Then I delete this line. Then I take this E equal as my definition. This is go beyond the pointwise definition. This is the weak derivative. Solve the first question. Then if gradient U is only in L2, how do we understand the PDE? Okay, this is the definition of weak solution. Namely that I do that. Then I integration by part. Then I forget that line. I take this as my definition. There are really two different things. One is understand the estimate. That's definition of weak derivatives. You look at all the functions, his gradient is in L2. Then for those kind of functions, how do you understand the PDE? Is this weak solution. Then the third is how this function really better. It's actually answered by the Sobolev embedding. Of course, you say the probability for this U in L2 is their fixed distribution for U to be near infinity. But here's a gradient in L2. Of course, that's decays. That makes the chances for the U to be infinity smaller. Then the theorem is the following. If gradient U is in L2, then U itself is in LP space. It's a 2n over n minus 2 dx, ball 1, 2n over n minus 2. This equals to this kind of. I mean, I'm losing my count of this constant. And you see this is a number in general is bigger than 2, which geometrically what that means is I make the decay of the distribution function sharper. Is U is less likely to be infinity once you say gradient have this kind of things. And let me end my lecture by showing you how do you like remember this kind of constants. Then in my second lecture I don't use them but in my third lecture I will use that in an essential way. So before I do that, maybe I'm running out of time. Let me stop here. Then next lecture I will show you a way how do you remember these constants. Thank you.